Welcome all. For me, it's a great pleasure to be here at Odyssey, along with my colleague, Merel Havenhals. And it's also a great pleasure to see that, well, so many people are interested in the topic of interoperability, trust, and success in digital ecosystems, because this is quite a subject. And we were talking how to provide a good presentation to, on the one hand, provide the basic principles of standards on how to get to interoperability, and on the other hand, zoom in on some, how do you say, certain challenges, to connect standards with those challenges, to make it practical. So I will do the first part, the general introduction, I would say, and the second part will be given by my colleague Merel. So we are from NEN, just hands in the air, if I may ask, who is familiar with our organization, who knows us? Quite some people. Are you also actively involved within standardization or just knowing the institute?
Just knowing the institute.
Others as well?
Yeah.
Okay. Then I will kick off. Then it's a good thing to have this presentation here. All right. So yesterday I was also present here at Odyssey, and what struck me was that so many interesting challenges were presented, 21 of them, really interesting challenges. And they are presented to a global community of expertise to solve these solutions of tomorrow and to spark innovation. And in some way, Rutger also told it, a portal is opening to the future with these challenges. But for us, it is also evident that in order to grasp success in those future challenges, it is also important to look at the past and to look at the systems that facilitate the new ways of doing. And that's why I'm here. So I will give a kickoff with a small look on our organization, and then I will try to bring it into the bigger picture, which is quite challenging. So NEN, our organization was founded in 1916. So over 104 years ago, people were already thinking about how to standardize, how to create efficiency, how to create market access, economies of scale, etc. So our organization is a non-profit organization. And it was founded by the Institute of Engineers and by the Institute of Traders. And the first topic they worked on were the bolts for the railway systems. So they all have the same size. That's where it all started. So between then and now, 104 years later, a lot of things have changed. And you might ask yourself, well, what does a organization, a standardization organization, contribute over those years? And the most effective way to display our contribution and the contribution of our stakeholders and our community members is this chart, is this mapping of the several eras of industrial revolutions. Are you all familiar with these stages? I see people nodding. Yes? Okay. So just a fast look, a quick look. In the first industrialization, mechanization, steam power, weaving, etc. So in the second era, 2.0, you see mass production, assembly line, and electrification. And that is exactly one of those moments in time, a bit later, as you can see, 1916 and 1870, when people were starting to think about standardization. And along the way, after the Second World War in 1974, the Global Standardization Organization was founded, and a bit later the European one. So during these four industrial revolutions, and we are now in the fourth, standardization was a critical element for success. A critical element. This brings us to the current day about our institute. Some data, we have over 300 people inside working on all various topics. We have over 500 committees and a huge number of subcommittees and working groups and nearly 6,000 committee members. And those people are the ones who are drafting the standards. And this is one misconception about standardization and the institute, is that standards are drafted by the industry, by the market, not by the institute itself. So that's a really important thing to remember. On the international level, it's interesting to see, I won't go through this whole page, but that it was founded in 1974. And between that date and time, till now, there were over, or nearly, 23,000 international standards developed by a global community. So imagine how much work, how much effort, and also how much knowledge is captured within these documents. For Odyssey, and Merel will talk to that a bit later, all those documents, all that knowledge, is presented to you free of charge, which is quite unique. So you can dive into those topics of interest for your challenge, for other interests, and to look for knowledge. Quickly moving on, so you have two levels. You have a European level, which is really important to understand, and you have a global level. And between those two levels, you can make a separation between non-technical, technical, and telecommunication. And it will be really important to remember that later on. So it is a powerful community to be part of, or to, how do you say that? Wat is aansluiten op, iemand? To connect to, thank you. Odyssey Connect, you're right, my apology. Ah. So here again, those three different levels. So you have the national level, and each member state of the European Union has a formal standardization institute. Each member state, which is the national level. So you have DIN, BSI, etc. So Spain has one, Germany has one, etc. And there's also the European level, which is also connected to the European Commission. And there's the global level, which all countries around the world, or at least most of them, 164 countries in total, are connected by one powerful standardization community. And these communities cover nearly all sectors, all topics we are here for today. So whether it's construction, electricity, whether it's blockchain or AI, it's all covered within these communities in terms of standardization, which is important to keep in mind. And just to show you an example of how powerful these communities are, was the latest week, there was a press release about the UK leaving the European Union. And one of the first things they said, those three chairs, were, please keep in mind, if you want to retain your market access, you must comply to our standards. Which means a lot. Meaning, if you do not comply to the standards, which is something really different than regulation, you cannot put your product, your service, or anything you have come up with in our economic zone. And the second one, an example, was a bit earlier on this year, was the implementation of a great number of standards, NATO standards, which are also covered in this system, to Ukraine. Because when you go to war or you want to practice on warfare, you need to know how to communicate with each other at a very basic level, but also at a very complex and technical level. And that's why you also need those standards. It's also here for ballistic protection, etc. And there's one last example, and this was last week. It was Jonathan Turley, a professor at Georgia Washington University. And it's all about the impeachment inquiry. And this man said, well, this could set the standard for future presidents. And he's concerned about lowering impeachment standards. But is that about formal standardization? No, it's not. So impeachment standards have nothing to do with formal standards. Nothing. So this brings me to the variety of standards, which is also very important to understand that there's a very large variety if we talk about standards. So Merel and I are from the formal standardization body, which every European country has and a lot of the world. But there's also a lot of market standardization or domain standardization or sectors or even company standardization. So when you are working on your challenge or you are trying to interact with ecosystems or community members, please keep in mind that all those different areas have their own set of rules, the rules of the game. And it's very important to know about those rules of the game. And then, given the previous varieties, so you have all these different appearances, you might say, well, Mark, what are standards then about? What is it exactly? Well, basically, it's captured knowledge. It is a consensus-based document, most of the time, where you can find best practices or information about a certain topic, circularity or energy transition or... And also performance levels or criteria. So it's really diverse. And those formal standards, which is also, again, very important to understand, the formal standards are linked with regulation on national European level. And sometimes standards are also related to legal issues. This might give you a more complete view of how standards should be perceived in an economic environment. And then there's the process, your options as an audience. So now that you know about standardization, you basically have three options. The first one is just comply. So when an ecosystem member or a customer says, well, these are our own rules, you can comply. Or secondly, you can try to get to the table and start trying to influence what's in the standard, meaning drafting the standard. And the third one is for really, well, large corporate organizations or parties with a lot of market power, I would say, for example, Apple. And it's just to demonstrate your wisdom and power. If they set the standard, the market complies. So if you want to release an app in the App Store or the Android Store, you have to comply to their set of rules. Given the time, thank you, Merel. I've only 4 slides left. It's always shorter than in preparation, but okay. So the essentials of knowledge creation can be depicted or can be captured in a few knowledge sources. One of those sources can be standards. One, the diversity of standards. The other ones means you need to know about regulation. You need to know about patents, about protecting your knowledge. Some publications open on the web or in exchange from research, and also other trusted sources. Meaning you have to really look into where is this knowledge that I need to know, that I need to capture for solving my challenge, whether it's an Odyssey challenge or any other challenge. Which brings me to the final two slides, my apologies. So those are just a few simple tips. If you start to figure out your configuration, you start by looking at your theme. So what is my field? of expertise? Is it circularity? Is it energy? Is it technology? Then you go one step further and you ask yourself, what's the domain I'm in? Because circularity in an office environment is something different than for a recycling plant. There's really different solutions to be made. And then there's the level. Is your level, is your solution for a micro level, meaning for a single problem owner? Is it for a local community, or somewhat bigger? Or is it global? Which really means you have to think about what is the ecosystem, what is the community around my problem? And then you have a higher chance of solving it. And then the last two, you need to map your stakeholders. And given the previous slide, and then I will conclude. No, I'm too far, my apologies. So you have these essential elements, and you have also essential stakeholders. There are a lot of stakeholders who are nice to have, and a few are need to have. You have really get those involved, the need to have stakeholders, and build your circle around it with nice to have stakeholders. And then the final one, a mapping of all relevant rules of the game. And when you have that in place, it's much easier to come up with a solution. So that's my first part, I would say. Given the time, a short round of questions and answers. Are there any questions so far? None. Okay, that can be the case.
Okay.
Merel.
Yes. Okay. Oh, it's already on? Okay,
yeah,
great.
It's on.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
So you're probably quite overwhelmed at this point in the day, having heard so much information. So I'm hoping to get your attention for the next 20 minutes. I will show you how the information you just heard can be translated to some of the challenges. We picked out a few, but know that we have information on all of them when it comes to standards. And also, after each case, you have the possibility to put in some questions you have via Mentimeter. We will probably not answer them now, but then we can answer them, you know, in a couple days, and we can get back to you. So I will focus on a couple, I think three or four cases, and from three approaches. So first of all, I'm showing how standard developments connect national, European, and international level. Secondly, I'm showing how we as standardization institutes connect to other ecosystems, so not just standardization, but also research projects, green deals, governance, all types of different ecosystems where we integrate our knowledge on standardization. And lastly, knowledge sourcing, so using insights from already existing standards and their underlying network of experts for your challenges. Know that they are there and we can give you the entrance to them. So first of all, healthcare. The acute healthcare is very much under pressure. As you know, once there is a crisis or an epidemic, the healthcare network is overloaded. It's hard to keep coordination. There's a lack of personnel, and also the data and the applications that are developed are not interoperable, at least not in most cases. So that's a really big problem. So what's happening now in Holland, explained by the Minister of Health, that you know, healthcare providers often do not have the information they need, and patients need to repeat themselves multiple times to different actors in the network to explain what they need and how serious their condition is. So currently they're building a roadmap with 10 priorities, and those 10 priorities are looking at, they're urgent because in terms of electronic data exchange, they need attention. So there's a top 10, and acute healthcare is most likely one of them. And standardization is a very important part in this roadmap because we were asked by the program to come up with a standardization program that first of all looks at what's already in place, so what standards are already there and we can make use of, not only formal standards but also market standards. Secondly, once we've mapped those, we can see what gaps there are, so what needs to be filled in order to get a comprehensive system for data exchange. And as you can see, we have a covenant with other Dutch standardization organizations, so not the formal ones, but like the market institutions, in order to get, you know, from that connection, fill the gaps and align the work we are doing in multiple places. So this is, for example, a standard, a European standard, that says something about what type of data we should put down, in this case for an international patient summary. So it defines the core data set for a patient. And I think, of course, what's in this standard is very important, but especially the process of how this standard came to be and all the people and countries involved that said, this is the standard we are going to use, is what makes it so powerful. Another example, as NEN and also other European standardization institutes, we link to different types of research projects. So for example, No Fear, it focuses on emergency medical system as well. And here we work together with universities, governmental organizations, different parties who want to bring together all the relevant stakeholders and see what types of innovation do practitioner needs, for example, and what's already there, what do we need to develop together, and also what types of standards do we need in order to make sure that new ideas, new innovations can actually be used and can actually be used in the infrastructure that's already in place. And I've worked on a couple of those projects, and often what I hear is, okay, this project is very nice and people are very involved and active and, you know, bring in their expertise and we have a lot of good ideas, but then once the project ends, you know, the money runs out, the project ends, and then there's nothing left. So what we try to do with standardization is already during the project connect the research outcomes to existing standardization ecosystems in order for it to find a way to new standards, etc. So that's what we try to do in these cases. Okay, so who has a question? Then I will open up the Mentimeter. No, are you? Everything is very clear for you? Okay. Maybe what we do is, if there are no questions, I'll open it up at the end, and then any questions you might have at that point, you can fill in. Otherwise, we'll lose unnecessary time. I will go to the next challenge. It's on the self-sovereign identity. So people, organization having sole ownership of their digital or analog identity. So a big question here is, the challenge wants to, you know, research what's possible and all the complexities about it. And what questions you might have is like, how do you verify this identity? How do you make sure that an identity is acknowledged not only here, but also in other countries? So that's what they are working on in international and at European level in an ISO committee on blockchain and DLT. And what they do here is, first they start with the foundation. So what, when we talk about blockchain, what do we mean, and all the terms and definitions, that how, will we make sure that we speak the same language? And also identity, like I said, how do we see what the identity is? How do we make sure that we can trust it? And also what they do here, and I really like that, is that they actively look for use cases. So they look for use cases to see how the technology can be used in different sectors for different types of cases, because they need to make sure that it's adjusted accordingly. And in Europe, what they do is they look at the ISO standards, of course that's the international level, and they see what extra layer do we need in Europe in order to comply to GDPR, etc. So in Holland, we have the Dutch Standards Committee on Blockchain, and that committee mirrors the developments internationally, but also they have a different project in collaboration with the Blockchain Coalition, where they have a proposal for guidelines on the use of standards for identification of subjects, objects within the design of blockchain systems. And my colleague told me he's working on this, and he said, like, most of the time, people don't even know that there are so many standards already exist and people can make use of, and they come up with new, you know, trying to work to a law and regulation, but actually there are already many standards that can provide you with the same boundaries to work within. Okay, I'll skip this one, and please, if you have questions at the end, come and talk to us or send it via Mentimeter at the end. I'll go over to the next example. That's standards for an upscaling economy on plastics. So it's a different case. What you see here is that that there is no viable plastic supply chain yet, because mainly because of issues concerning the sourcing of plastic. And what I want to do here is create a link to another case, of which I think it was confronted with a similar type of challenge. So, and that is of the sourcing of cacao. Here as well, the social aspects were preventing a viable and sustainable supply chain. So here as well, it's very labor intensive process. People were living in poor conditions. There was the risk of use of child labor, unreliable infrastructure, and often people had a low income. So it's a very different situation than what you would have in Europe, for example. We're talking about developing countries, and it's a whole different context to deal with. So how to create a proof and prove a healthy work environment when you have such a case? Well, the example of cacao shows how that can be done, because from Holland we initiated a cooperation with the Guinean Standardization Institute, and together initiate on an international level the creation of standards. And in this era there were already a lot of standards in place, which you probably know. But the point of the ISO standard is that this gives you sets a benchmark, because the development process involves so many stakeholders and is very, people trust the process behind ISO standards. So it's really a name, and it has a certain power behind it. So they developed four standards. They were published last year, and together they help cacao farmers to professionalize their business by giving performance requirements on economic, social, environmental criteria, and also to, when they conform, they can like international investors can trust the fact that they sourced it in a sustainable way. So that's for their, that's also what it says here, like, those who choose to meet the requirements of the standards will be in a better position to develop into economically viable entrepreneurs. So it's very much to help the people over there, but also to create this viable supply chain. And here is just an overview of the stakeholders that are involved via NEN, so via the Dutch Standardization Institute. Those are stakeholders in the whole supply chain, private, public, NGOs, universities, everyone was involved here. Questions at this point? Yes. No question is stupid.
Okay, you mentioned that there may be so many standards, right?
Yes.
So one could be spoiled by choice as to which standard shall I choose.
Yes.
Is that so? And if these standards are formulated, let us say, by technology, while we want technology to be smart, mm-hmm. do we want technology to be smarter than humans so that if a particular standard is formulated via technology which has not been set out before, do we dare to apply it? It might lead to some disastrous effect. I don't know whether it's a stupid question, but we're talking about technology and all that, okay?
I'm just checking if I understand your question, right?
There are two questions, actually.
Okay.
Two separate questions. So you said, there may be so many standards vis-a-vis a particular thing. Mm. So I'm spoiled for choice.
How do you choose?
How do I choose? And secondly, if the standards are formulated or established by technology, via technology, and if this technology, AI, is smarter than the human beings, mm-hmm. somehow it goes through the past and finds a new formula which has not been thought of before by humans. If you follow that process, it might be, it's a double edge. It could lead to, if you're doing an experiment, mm-hmm. it might lead to something disastrous.
I think we're not at the point yet that technology will develop standards. Because
but I understand
that
in the health sector,
yes.
for example, in the health sector, mm-hmm. when you use technology to determine the X-ray, so first of all, in the past, okay, so through technology, you may say, oh, if this, then it's cancer, okay? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But it might well be, and I'm told, in the actual case, the technology be then do, this is cancer, but how did the technology find that when mm-hmm. blah, 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 that's cancer, when it may not be, and then you administer the wrong medicine? So this one, technology becomes smarter than the humans.
Yeah, and I think there's a lot of discussion about that currently, especially, for example, around artificial intelligence, like what requirements do you need to put in a standard in order to say, like, this AI application is honest, is giving me a fair result? So that's, of course, it's a very tricky discussion because it's so new, and I think what they're working on right now is the mainly the ethical issues around it, and seeing, you know, how can we prevent such a bias, for example. So what do data sets need in order to not get this bias? And then that's all being, you know, constructed right now.
Right, but while humans, you can say ethical standards.
Yeah.
Do you attribute ethics to a machine? You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
Because for humans, you can say the moral standard, but mm-hmm. for a machine,
Yeah, I think for now that's a discussion. I mean, that's a very interesting question, but I would love to talk with you about that later. But the first question was, how do you choose a standard when there are so many? And I think that all comes back to how it has come, how the process was and how many people were involved. And ISO standards are, you know, very widely recognized, so that's also why people prefer an ISO standard over another standard of which they don't know the quality, they don't know who were involved, they don't know how they came about. So that's all about the process and involvement of all stakeholders.
Also from a legal point of view, if you apply an ISO standard which is legally recognized,
Yes.
And should something happen and you go to court,
yeah, then you're covered.
Due diligence. Mm-hmm. Unless you apply a standard that's not internationally recognized,
yeah,
then the court might say, well, we have not exercised due diligence.
Mm-hmm.
So I think there is a need to apply an internationally recognized standard.
Yes, definitely. Yeah.
So how do these companies survive then if they have, if it's not licensed or
mm-hmm.
why would they have standards if there is an overall international standard? Would it make sense if I'm a company that already there are mm-hmm. standards, that I've got another different set of standards which from the legal point of view
mm-hmm.
may not be suitable?
Yeah, I think in many cases it's sector specific, and there's a certain need that goes beyond the standards that are in place. So, for example, for in the environmental sector, when it comes the soil quality, for example, then there is a standard, but it might be too generic for the Dutch situation. So then the sector comes up with sort of additional requirements. So that could be an example. But I'm moving on, if that's okay.
Actually,
yes. Yeah, I follow up with the mic. So,
and actually, yeah. Not just that, it just follows on what you okay. just said, but I'll give you a context. I'm with the Sovereign Nature Challenge. We're part of the lead, and it's about protecting biodiversity or the ecosystem in the high seas.
Mm-hmm.
But my question is, I think it's just in general about standards for the collection of environmental information, which you just touched on,
mm-hmm.
and the dissemination. What should be should I be thinking about? And I know little about, very little or nothing about the European system or America or South America. I know,
yeah.
for example, Mexico has something similar. But mm-hmm. what can you tell me so I could be follow up on this or think about it?
Is that something we could talk about afterwards? Is that because I think it deserves a longer answer than what I can give you right now? Yeah? Yeah, question.
So normally when you think about standards, right, it's within an industry, right? Or within a sector.
Mm-hmm.
So with blockchain and distributed ledger technologies, you're talking about various businesses,
yes.
from across sectors.
Definitely.
Coming together and working, right? So based on your experience, your institution's experience, do you see any precedents in the past where businesses from different sectors coming together to develop standards?
Yes.
Or do you see that as a new phenomenon?
I think it's quite new, right? I mean, in the past, it was very much focused on a certain sector. But of course, with these new technologies, you have to look beyond those boundaries. So, and I think people are very happy to do so. And there's an even more exchange of knowledge, exchange of information, because applications of blockchain or AI in one sector can learn from another sector. So it's really an added value for them to exchange that information. And also what you see is often you start with the generic requirements and then you focus on the specific needs of certain sectors, but always keep the linkage between them to exchange knowledge. So that's normally how it goes, you know, from generic to more specific. Yeah. Other, yeah?
So usually standards are understood as something that, well, maybe it's a wrong impression, something that locks the status quo, meaning it locks what's currently like a state of the art.
Mm-hmm.
And with the emerging technologies which sort of develop very quickly, those standards immediately become obsolete. So how do we deal with that? I mean, because then standards may sort of prevent the industry, whatever, the whole
yeah.
technology to develop, rather mm-hmm. than help anything. So
I can answer. Yeah,
we have to answer.
Yeah, I have. Is it on or?
Yeah.
Well, the short answer is standards are developed for a certain time frame. So what is considered today as really on the edge of technology will be tomorrow in another stage, and perhaps over 10 years or 15 years, it's indeed obsolete, and then the standard will get removed from.
In the speed of development, 10 years is already too much. After 1 year, it will be obsolete.
Yeah, you're right. Yeah, you have also a high dynamic standard. So the use is that you need the standard in order to invest in a certain technology, and. Of course, the technology evolves in time, and you have to. Yeah, how do I explain it? Will it be possible to provide more? I'm trying to shorten it down.
No, I mean the whole community is looking at faster ways to generate standards, and of course, because they know this issue and they are trying to get fast track procedures, etc. But it's all about people getting involved and making time to actually write those standards. So it's actually about the people in the industries and organizations that need to give this commitment. I think we have to close. So what I would like to say is we're ready to help with the challenges. I gave a few examples of what you can expect, and this was just a glimpse of what's out there in the standardization ecosystem. So please contact us if you feel like, okay, this could be of help to our challenge. Please connect with us, get in touch with us, our colleagues. Like Mark said, make use of the database of standards, and also make use of our network and all the expertise that is there.
Thank you.
I think that, okay, great. Thank you.